Hello and welcome to today's webinar. Let's talk about the weather and its impact on pests, brought to you by Pest Management Professional Magazine and our sponsor of the event, BASF. My name is Ellen Wagner. I'm from North Coast Media. I'm the digital editor for Pest Management Professional. I'll be your event manager for today's presentation. Before we get started, I want you to let you know that today's webinar will be recorded. You are currently in listen mode only. A recording of this webinar will be posted afterwards to pmp.net/webinars and will also be emailed to you tomorrow. At this time, I'd like to you to get comfortable with our console and the ways you can participate during today's presentation. Please notice the Q&A panel on the left-hand side of your console. If you have a question, type it in the text box, then click submit to place your question in the queue. You may also use the hashtag PMPWebinar on Twitter to submit your questions during today's webinar or to enter into discussions with other attendees. We encourage you to ask and answer any questions you may have for our speaker during the presentation, and we'll address these questions at the end of the presentation during the Q&A portion. Questions submitted during the registration have already gone to our speaker and may be covered during the presentations. If you experience any technical difficulties during today's event, you may use the same Q&A panel on your screen to submit your issue, and assistant producer Aurora Harris or I will personally assist you. You may learn more about today's speaker and moderator by viewing their photo and bio and contact information in the panel located in the bottom left-hand corner of your console. If you are logged into your social media accounts, you can share the webinar's title, description, and URL with your friends or colleagues using the Share This widget that is placed below the slides. Also on the right-hand side, the Refer a Colleague panel will allow you to email today's webinar information to a coworker or other industry professionals. Now we'll introduce today's speaker. Today we'll be hearing from Dr. Tim Husen, BCE, who is the Technical Services Representative for BASF, Professional and Specialty Solutions covering the Southeast U.S. In this role, Tim supports BASF's innovation and product launch platforms and provides direct support to BASF, Professional and Specialty Solutions sales and marketing teams. At this time, I'll turn the presentation over to Tim. So, Tim, take it away.
Let me unmute. Thank you, Ellen, for the introduction. Thank you, everyone, for attending today. As we said, we're going to be talking about the weather and its impacts on seasonal pests. You know, we didn't, luckily for you all, Ellen didn't read my entire bio, but during my time in operational pest management, one of my roles out there in the world was a safety director. For a pest management company. In that role, you know, I always learned that the easiest way not to show up for work tomorrow is a safety-related incident today. So we are going to start today's meeting off just like every meeting should be with a relevant safety message. And as we enter the fourth quarter of the year, you know, seasons are changing. Per the title of the talk today, but ladders, all of us know ladder safety at work, right? An incredibly important thing, but a lot of us sometimes forget about ladder safety at home, right? We're hitting the time of the season when we often go from you know, your normal looking house to something like this. I don't know about any of your neighborhoods out there, but even now in October, my neighborhood starts changing, right? And it starts looking like this. You know, ladder is essential for hanging Christmas lights. I got myself a 30-footer, right? To get up and put up the lights that my wife once put up. But it's a critically important tool for hanging Christmas lights or Halloween lights, just like it's a critical inspection and service tool for pest management providers. You know, I recently watched someone in my neighborhood go up 20 feet a ladder. Carrying an aerosol can, right? Going up to spray a bald-faced hornet's nest up there. Like, we're working and operating at heights sometime, and training and attention to detail and safety is critically important, right? It's always important that we know our limits, right? On a ladder, right? Know, even if I'm this high, how high can I go without climbing support or harnessing support or without someone supporting the ladder below me, Right. I always, you know, go to darwinwinds.com or whatever website you want to find online. You can find pictures like this, right? It's important to remember gravity always wins, right? You know, if you asked OSHA about gravity, I want to thank my friends there at Quality Fumigation out there in Santa Ana, California, for the pictures they submitted to my technical cohort out there on the West Coast. But OSHA would like to remind folks that requirements for fall protection and harnessing equipment, in their eyes, when you're walking or working on a surface with an unprotected edge, that's 6 feet or more above the lower level. That's when harnessing or height protection or height or fall protection equipment would be recommended by them. Quickly, U.S., we lead the world in ladder-related deaths. There are most ladder-related deaths happen from falls of 10 feet or less. 500,000 emergency room visits annually, more than 300 ladder fatalities per year, right? OSHA considers all ladder accidents as preventable. So there is available safety equipment, climber training, right? Equipment training only good if we put what we're learning into action right out in the field. Like I said earlier, I watched this guy climbing up. I think he even had a bellows duster on his belt loop or something in case he was going to get really close after he'd knocked down some of those bald-faced hornets, right? But he's climbing up this ladder with equipment and with gear in his hands, right? And it's estimated 50% of accidents happen while we're carrying something up that ladder. You know, I know a lot of us out there have ladder safety training that we go through, but it's always important to remember to be safe. Ensure the functionality and safety mechanisms are properly functioning on your ladder. Make sure your ladder is anchored. And it always helps that someone else besides you knows where you are, right, when you're climbing up a ladder in case there's an incident where you do fall and you hurt yourself and you can't reach a phone, you can't reach to contact someone, that they know that potentially they should be looking out for you or look to hear from you after you're using that ladder. So thank you for the quick safety message. I tried to keep it brief. But let's get back to the weather, right? So today we're going to be talking about so to say, seasonal pests, right? And there's four seasons in the year. And I really focus on the seasons of rebound and action for pests, right? When they're rebounding in the spring, summer, they're at peak performance. Then there's, so to say, a regression or an action time in the fall of pest populations. So we're really going to be focusing on spring and fall seasonal pests, a little more on fall because that's where we are in the year right now. But first things first, you know, I have to ask everybody that's out there, you don't need to type it into the Q&A, but think deeply, what did you want to be when you grew up, right? I don't know how many of us, if you asked, you know, 6, 7, 8-year-old Tim, he certainly wouldn't have said, I think I want to be an entomologist, a bug doctor specializing in the coolest insects on earth, urban insects, right? Urban pest insects. That's not what I would have said. You know, third grade Tim was blown away on that field trip to the news station when he saw the local weatherman, right, and all the scientific tools and the very, like, primitive 1980s Doppler radar, right, that they were using back then. But, I mean, my mom had a master's degree in education. My dad is a medical doctor, a real doctor, not a bug doctor like me. But if you would have asked me that day at that news station, neither of their jobs mattered, right? What they were doing didn't matter. I wanted to be a weatherman, right, because they were cool. They played with the coolest toys. They were on TV. They were constantly talking to people. You know, they were always right at the forefront, right? So I just remember vividly coming back from that field trip thinking that. So in honor of that, I am going to change today's title to Al Roker and I. Forecasting for seasonal invaders. I do have some Al Roker quotes sprinkled throughout the talk today. So bear with me, but this is my one chance to act like I'm a weather guy, while also combining my real world job, right, of bug doctoring. So today's agenda, we're going to talk about a forecast, really. What is a forecast? What is in a forecast? Does it differ between a weather forecast and a pest forecast, right? We're going to be talking about seasonal versus occasional invaders. Oftentimes, these terms are used synonymously in our industry. I'm not a fan of that. I prefer the term seasonal invaders versus occasional invaders, and we'll discuss why. We're going to talk about factors that influence seasonal pests, right? Why are they coming in? We're going to talk a little bit about who we might see in the different seasons, right? And a little bit about what, when, why they're there, right? We're going to end with some corrective action plans, discuss a few integrated management strategies, and then, of course, think about how we're communicating our weather forecast, our pest weather forecast, right, to our customers, and then in turn using that to help manage their expectations of our services. So starting off with Al, right? Al Roker says, weather forecasts are essential to the news business. On any given day, the weather forecast could be the story that directly impacts the highest number of people. When I turn on the news in the morning, there is no doubt it is the first thing I am looking for or waiting to hear about, right? When I turn on that news broadcasting, you know, 5:30 in the morning, I need to know what's going on for the rest of the day, right? That's my number one priority. What's my weather for the rest of the day? You know, beyond that, you know, what else is coming down the line? Then I'll hear about some other news, right? But that weather forecast, right? That the forecast definition, a prediction or estimate of future events, right? Sometimes it's an hour by hour for that day, right? Sometimes then we'll get to the 7-day outlook, right? Sometimes beyond that, we're looking at fall or we're looking at seasonal trends even on that weather forecast, right? They're using a large amount of data. I think 41-year-old Tim would now like to go to a weather station. I haven't been to one since I was in third grade, right? Or a news station and seen the weather, so to say, the weather hub, right? Or to see the technology that they're using now to track, you know, barometric pressure and to track air currents and high pressure and low pressure and how the technology has evolved to get to where we are today, where you're looking at literally the hook, right, of a tornado, let's say a hook on that Doppler radar. They're getting down into that level, that degree of data coming in that they're able to make, you know, these statements about what's happening. They do, as I say there, there's a lot of data variables coming in that are available for that weather forecast. It is all about risk and risk management, right? They color code things, right, on those weather patterns to let you know that something is severe or not severe, right? So risk and mitigating risk, that's their job, to protect people. Just like, I mean, what are we doing as pest management professionals, right? Protecting people every day. Weather stations, you'll hear them all the time talking about accuracy, you know, the most accurate forecast, or, you know, or sometimes they use the term precision, right? I think it's important to differentiate those two. Remember, accuracy describes error. Okay, accuracy is how close their forecast is to what actually happened, right? That's important. Precision, it describes the closeness of measurements to each other, right? So that actually describes the variability that you have in your forecast as it relates to accuracy, right? Both of them are important, but in weather, accuracy is where they're really, you know, that's the key one is how close were we, right, with our forecast. In a pest forecast, there's not that much that's different, right? We're still pest management professionals providing a pest forecast. We're still predicting or estimating future events, right? Sometimes, you know, if I'm a company on a monthly or every other month or quarterly or even triannual service interval, I may be forecasting a service stop down the line, two service stops down the line, you know, half a year down the line to my customer base, depending on what type of customer they are, right? And the forecast I'm delivering to them may change based off of what services they have with me right now. If they're a general pest control customer alone, maybe I'm forecasting services that they don't have with me right? To try to draw their attention to them. I know seasonal trends. I know peak periods of pest populations, right? I've got data associated with, you know, what are my phones ringing on year over year over year, this month, this month, this month, this month, right? Unfortunately, what are my callback pests, right? I have data on that too. And we'll touch more about the revenue and the profitability of pests in a little bit. But I certainly am still taking into account all sorts of data variables. Risk is still a huge, huge thing, right? Seasonal pests, right? You know, public health pests that are out there, mosquitoes, ticks, stinging insects, the potential for allergic reactions to other seasonal, like fall seasonal invaders. There are risks out there, you know, and certainly if there's a public health factor associated with your seasonal pest, certainly something that can be, you know, put forth as a risk variable. Accuracy and precision for us, you know, those scientific nerd terms involving variability, error, and statistics, you throw those out the window. We have to be both accurate and precise. That's what our customers expect, right? And they don't really care about the difference between the two. Remember, they just don't want to have pests, right? But it's up to us to make sure that we're capturing all of that in our pest forecast. So there are pest forecasts out there. There are, you know, I consider the Al Roker of the pest forecast world, because when you see Al in the morning, he's got the whole nation map up, right? Jet streams going everywhere. One minute he's talking about Portland, Oregon. The next minute he's talking about Boston, Massachusetts, right? He's jumping everywhere. He's giving a 10,000 foot view of what you might expect across the country. NPMA, the National Pest Management Association, does a great job, an excellent job of Al Rokering the pest forecast, right? And they do this through their bug barometer. You can find it at npmapestworld.org. But the bug barometer, it's put out twice a year. They have a spring, summer, so to say, bug barometer forecast, and a fall, winter bug barometer forecast. It takes into account, you know, predicted weather patterns, established seasonal trends, and it tracks, you know, your forecast in terms of pest pressure or likely pest pressure of ants, beetles, you know, true bugs or so to say, plant feeding bugs outside, cockroaches, flies, mosquitoes, rodents, of course, stinging insects, biting arthropods like ticks. They're all, so to say, accounted for in this national forecast. And it really gives you something that you can start with and then work from to kind of zero down in on your very localized, right? Your very localized pest forecast, right? That's not why I get up at 5:30 in the morning. I have a 2-year-old. That's why I get up at 5:30 in the morning. But I also get up and watch the weather at 5:30 in the morning. Like I said, I trust my local forecast because they haven't spent all of their time worrying and developing their script, so to say, for a national picture. They're telling me what's happening, you know, in the 40-county area that they broadcast in North Georgia, right? I live in Cumming, Georgia. Georgia has a lot of counties, something like 110 or 112 counties, by the way, lots of counties. But the local forecast, that's what I'm trusting. That's what's guiding my decision, right? And you have the opportunity, being that local PMP in your area, to take this national perspective and push it and build from it, right? And design your own tools or your own forecasts for your own customer base. That's the quick run through, you know, a forecast. And really, it's not that different. a lot of the factors were exactly the same from a weather forecast to a pest forecast. We're forecasting, in my opinion, for seasonal pests, right? Defining occasional, I know those two terms are often thrown about, you know, synonymously, and sometimes I find myself still saying occasional even when I don't mean it. But occasional, the true definition is occurring or appearing infrequently and irregularly, versus the definition of seasonal is characteristic or restricted to a time of year. And yes, we certainly do have both types of pests. But, you know, when I look at those words, infrequently and irregularly, right? If I was sitting in a room with some of you today, I would say, do you have, you know, occasional pests, occasional invaders? And you would say yes. And then I would say, do they appear infrequently and irregularly? And you would say, well, what do you mean by that? And I would say, you know, do they come out of nowhere, or are they characteristic to a certain time of year? Right. And you would eventually land on the same side as me, as no, they're a seasonal pest. I see them every year, right, at that time. Nope, hitting the wrong button. But occasional pests, I'd like to thank NASA, just so everyone knows, every NASA image from space is essentially public domain. You can get incredible shots. But occasional pests occur or appear infrequently or irregularly, right? You know, worst case examples here, we're looking at forest fires. We're looking at natural disasters, hurricanes, tornadoes, torrential flooding. Right, all of these things that are terrible, terrible things. You know, I pulled one Al Roker quote that didn't really reference natural disasters at all, but I kind of piggybacked it too. And the moral of the story is, you know, Al's gone through some ups and downs, weight loss cycle, just like me. No one told me I wasn't supposed to gain the first 25 pounds with my daughter of her life, but I'm working on it, folks. But Al used to love his refrigerator. And I love my refrigerator too, especially after, you know, thunderstorms, natural disasters, bad things weather-wise. If the power goes out, right, for an extended period of time, and there's a disturbance in normal function, right, pests know how to respond to that, right? They know how to take advantage of that. As the recent hurricanes that came through and really hit hard in Louisiana, they worked their way up the coast, flooding areas throughout the coastline going up to the north. I mean, there was all sorts of articles. This is September 19th of this year. You know, this is what happens to all the rats when cities flood, right? They know where to go to survive. I mean, there was reports in the article of rats treading water for 3 days, right? They're going to find high ground, or they're going to swim, or they're going to tread water for as long as they need to survive, right? I'm not just thinking from the pest perspective. Of course, as pest management professionals, always as companies, have a plan for how you're going to respond to this situation. I mean, taking care of your employees and their families first, and making sure that everyone's taken care of. Have a plan for how you're going to respond business-wise, right? If your business or your branch has been impacted, what's going to happen, right? Have all those plans locked in place so that you can actually focus on the pests that are going to rebound after those disasters, these occasional invaders, right? Rodents, as I mentioned, mosquitoes, if there's areas prone to flooding that aren't typically flooded or sitting with stagnant water for that long of time, when food rots and trash gets drugged to the street, right? Flies, roaches, all sorts of potential wildlife options all become occasional invaders because they're not normally there. Certainly not in the numbers and the levels you're dealing with after a natural disaster, right? So to sum all that up, here's a Dr. Tim quote. To put it scientifically, remember, pests ain't stupid, right? They know how to survive, and they know how to take advantage when the environment is right for them. Coming back to it, transitioning from occasional, right, to seasonal, think to yourself, is something occasional if I see it at the same time every year, right? And to me, that is that characteristic textbook definition, characteristic of or restricted to a time of year, right? That is a seasonal pest. Right, there's going to be all sorts of factors that impact seasonal pests. Right, most importantly is going to be nighttime temperature has a significant impact. Right, it's not necessarily daytime temperature. Bugs, insects, arthropods, they can survive temperature fluctuations, temperature extremes. But when it gets cool at night, right, insects are a nerd term, poikilothermic, right, cold blooded, right? Cold-blooded insects. They don't like getting cold at night. They can fluctuate and swing, but really driving biological processes is this reaction to nighttime temperature, this reaction to photoperiod, or the change in the amount of daylight, right? The temperature that you get during the day doesn't so much matter, but the amount of light, the sun's perspective and how much light the bug actually receives impacts its biological processes, right? And seasonal pests sometimes can be accidental, right? They become a pest, they get inside, they can't complete their life cycle in here. They also can't necessarily find their way back out, right? They most likely should have found something somewhere to overwinter or do whatever they were going to do outside, but that didn't happen. Versus there sometimes can be adaptive pests where they can move inside and they can complete they can live their life cycle inside if conditions exist correctly for them. So back to that temperature photo period thing, you know, I think it was my cousin Vinny where she's talking, slamming on the, Marissa Tomei is slamming on the desk saying, my biological clock is ticking, right? But insects have a biological clock, a circadian clock, right? And it's really driven by those nighttime temperatures and photo period, right? There's a neat study out of the Osaka University out of Japan all about the brain seasonality in bean bugs. They're, you know, a piercing, sucking insect, a bean bug. But they actually were able to track the increase and decrease in egg laying or oviposition. That's oviposition is the entomological term for egg laying, right? The release or the increased release or the decreased release of oviposition or egg laying promoting molecules from the brain, all in response to temperature, right? Nighttime temperature, and then the amount of light that those bugs were being exposed to, right? And it all comes from their brain, and it's all driving these biological processes, right? I mean, there's a reason why when we talk with customers and they've got seasonal invaders, oftentimes, especially in the fall where we're at right now, that they're on the south or the west side of the house, right? The south or the west side of the house is going to get more sunlight. It's going to have more longevity or more prolonged thermal heat or thermal exposure as you enter the nighttime low, right? That pests are going to be attracted to that. Sometimes they'll find egress or enter into the structure, and sometimes they'll just remain on the outside of that structure. But, you know, it's the sun and its position and where it's hitting that's driving those bugs to be there. Sure, there are materials that home vinyl siding, white vinyl siding. There's different materials out there that may reflect or heat up differently, perhaps bringing more bugs towards that house. But in general, the south and west side here in the fall are going to be the hot spots based on temperature and photo period for those seasonal invaders. So they're entering really looking for foods. If they come in, you know, a seasonal pest, so this isn't just fall pests, this could be spring or fall seasonal pests, you know, they're entering structures looking for food, looking for mates. It's too hot, it's too cold, it's too wet, it's too dry, right? Sometimes I'm just looking to survive, right? This whole drive to survive and the mechanisms and the behaviors that are, so to say, hardwired into insects. I'm stealing a quote from Dr. Fred Baxendale, a guy that gave me some kind words of wisdom back when I was a graduate student at the University of Nebraska. He passed away recently. But he always called all of these weird intricacies and the weird things that bugs do, right, to survive, he called it nature's wondrous pageantry, right? And we can't change that or get in the way of that, right? Or in their eyes, at least. In our eyes, that's our job as pest management professionals. This is an industry. We are a service industry, right? And earlier I mentioned, you know, profit generation or revenue generating services. When you're thinking about seasonals, you know, maybe spring ants, maybe rodents, fall, you know, there's revenue coming in, right? For these services, right? Your top two revenue generating services, right? They are the top two profit generating services, but it's not even, right? We're not apples to apples. When you look at the graph on the right, that number is not the same number as in terms of profit percentage, right? Coming in at the top, right? Because seasonal pests are challenging pests, right? They're the ones that are really trying. They're really trying to come in or come out, you know, or come in most likely, but they're really trying to succeed or use the structure to do what they need to do, and that results in, you know, if it's my wife and she sees one smoky brown cockroach crawling in the fall, I thought you were an entomologist. I thought you could kill things. I thought, what are you going to do about it, right? You should all be lucky that she's not your customer. She's my customer. I take care of it. But you know, callbacks can really hurt. And especially for seasonal pests, they really can cut into that profit that we're expecting, right, from each season, right? If you look at seasonal pests in the spring, you know, I'm counting ants, I'm counting termites, I'm counting mosquitoes, I'm counting birds, right? Rebounding in the spring, potentially fleas, right? If the animal starts spending more time outside and has a place where it loafs or lays outside, you've been taking care of potential fleas inside, but outside, you know, those fleas could still be there, or they could be having a population rebound outside, right? So about 44%. This is a graphic that kind of breaks down into percentages deeper, where we're getting that total revenue industry wide there, but about 44% in the spring, right? There's a reason why the thing most pest control companies have, right? Your first piece of forecasting advertising, right? For your customers, right? If you're doing PC or TC, pest control or termite control work, right? There's a reason that this is a landing page on your company's website, most likely, right? Or that your sales folks are adept and ready to explain every aspect of differentiating an ant or a termite, right? We don't need to go through all of those. Hopefully you all know it, but right? But this graphic itself is forecasting, right? If you're showing this before the swarm season starts for those ants and termites, and you're using it as an explanation piece to guide, you know, a service, you are forecasting for those spring seasonal pests, those, you know, 35% of the revenue, total revenue, if you combine ants and termites. That is a humongous chunk, right? And very relevant spring seasonal pests. We also have, you know, things like millipedes coming out in the spring, migrating, right? Countless times I've been called to millipede migrations, right? They're living, they've overwintered in the landscape adjacent to that. We get heavy rains in spring, driving them out of that harborage area where they were. They'll migrate up, right, into the structure. You know, a challenging spring seasonal pest. Ticks, of course, you know, rebounding. Oh, they've survived the winter, perhaps as a nymph. Now they're an adult. You know, ticks have a multi-year life cycle. Certain ticks do, but they've rebounded. You look here; these articles aren't that deep into summer. They are just early summer articles, right? July 7th on the tick one, July 11th or June 11th on the mosquito article, right? But these things all started rebounding in the spring, and if we forecasted for them, for those mosquitoes, or we forecasted to our customer base that doesn't have mosquito control, right, to let them know, hey, there's, you know, in our area, you know, we can get with extension, and we can get with extension folks from universities, we can get estimates on, you know, what sort of tick pressure, what sort of mosquito pressure are we going to have. We can utilize that NPMA graphic to help drive conversations, especially for things that can make you sick, right? Tick-borne disease is actually more prevalent than mosquito-borne disease. West Nile virus is still out there. Areas that are endemic to triple E or eastern equine encephalitis. That is a disease that if the wrong person gets it, the survival rate is very poor, right? Someone that's susceptible or vulnerable, elderly, young, right? Your survival rate, if you get eastern equine encephalitis from a mosquito, is not great, right? Use those resources. We're not here to scare people, but we're being honest about a risk associated, right, with our forecast. And we have to take when the thunderstorm's bearing down, right, and they're counting lightning strikes and they're showing tornado hooks on the Doppler, right, and it's all those different colors. It's not just green anymore, right? They're stressing the risk. We're doing the same thing, right, with our forecasts for these pests. You know, there's going to be other pests that sometimes are out of your control. Different types of beetles, June bugs, beetles that are coming from way out in the landscape or even a neighbor's house, right? June bugs called June bugs, but really they should be called May bugs, right? That's when they come about more often. But birds, of course, you know, wild, like, you know, birds coming back. If you've got a bird control program or if you don't, right, there's an opportunity there to market yourself or to help forecast for, you know, in inner cities, what might birds do? You know, there's certainly a public health threat. There's mice, there's lice, there's other things that are associated with birds and bird nests that could impact folks. Into the fall seasonal pests. We're in fall now, so I'm going to spend a little more time with the fall pests, but about 42% of our total revenue. So those spring pests were about 44. Fall seasonal pests about 42%. You know, looking here at these percentages, you got rodents, you got spiders, neither of which are insects, right? But pests, relevant urban pest management, you know, pest targets that we deal with. You've got wildlife out there, right? All sorts of wildlife potential. You've got other, my favorite pests, right? I love it when people put other, but there you're thinking, you know, your paradomestic cockroaches, your large cockroaches that live outside, like the ones my wife loves to hate, smoky brown cockroaches. True bugs, you know, relatives of bed bugs that live outside on plants, piercing, sucking insects that live outside on plants. Stinging insects are going to be out there for those fall seasonal pests, right? So, you know, when you think about the fall, your rodent population has had all year, so to say, to build up to levels, right? You look at this image here, that's from February 13th of 2018, right? That's what a colony looks like in February. By the end of the year, those pups down at the bottom that have managed to survive, right, they're not pups anymore, right? If this population has gone unmitigated, right, they are looking for food, they are looking for resources, they are looking for nesting sites, right? Mice, if here we're looking at a picture of rats, but mice that are moving in from outdoors, right? They're not always just looking; they're more often looking for a place to nest or nesting materials, right, to stay warm over the winter. That is what is most important. But they've had all year to build up, and now they're starting to need resources. They need more, or they need very specific resources, right? Rodents do. Moving into spiders, you know, the joke is always that you eat about 25 spiders in your lifetime, but I always tell my wife, you can eat as many as you want. Treat yourself. You deserve it. But spiders are no laughing matter. Certainly not in terms of that revenue to profit quotient that we were talking about earlier when we were looking at the PMP state of the industry graphic, right? They're certainly a cut into or a cutter of profit, right? Spiders, large spiders sometimes are around structures. Larger spiders sometimes, remember, you have hunting spiders or you have web building spiders, right? They both exist. And sometimes the hunting spiders, your big, large wolf spiders, scare customers even more, right? Than a web building spider. Here in Georgia, I have been dealing with all kinds of calls from distribution folks, from pest management professionals, from companies out there. We are currently dealing with what I call when invasive meets seasonal. Recently, there was an introduction from Asia of a spider called the Joro spider. You can see it right there. It's a golden orb weaver spider, rather large, about palm-sized as a full-sized adult. Very, very large amount of eggs being laid by females, very quick population turnover, population explosion, so to say. You know, most homes, if there's not something being done about them, will have 5 to 6, 7 of them around the home right now. It's just been a really challenging year for pest management companies around here. here in North Georgia dealing with this thing, and it's going to spread away from here. It's a matter of time. But you know, the webbing around the house, I always tell my wife, we're going to save on Halloween decorations, right? But she doesn't buy that. Once again, it's a callback. Every time I get a new Joro spider building a web around my house. So I'm not saving on anything. The stinging insects of the fall, right? Your yellow jacket nests, right? That they've lived their whole life throughout the year. They've created fertilized queens. They come out of the nest, right? That bald-faced hornet nest I spoke about during the safety meeting down or during the safety moment at the beginning of the talk. Same thing. If that nest stayed up and wasn't remediated, right, we are going to have a bigger problem with more potential nests coming through as queens find overwintering spots and then build more nests on structures next year, right? But stinging insects are a risk, right? There is a risk associated with that. The risk of anaphylactic shock, the pain of an insect sting, right? In the fall, something I'm hearing a little bit less about in recent years, but definitely still out there, those multicolored Asian lady beetles, right? Another introduced insect that's become a pest, right? They're lady beetles. Our native lady beetles typically did not enter structures looking for a place to overwinter. These do. They kind of aggregate in masses where sometimes they will desiccate and dry out and die, leading to potential, you know, asthmatic reactions to the broken particulate matter of the skins in the air. All sorts of things could be associated with the multicolored Asian lady beetle. Every year, no matter what, I get a call like this. Right? What is this pest? Right? That's what I get. I get a Ziploc baggie with something like this in it. And I remind them, I actually wrote in a trade magazine about this one year, but I remind them that is just poop, right? That's the orange striped oakworm caterpillar going to turn into a Saturnian moth. One day as an adult, right? But the larva, the oak worm is eating the oak leaves, and they're dropping frass, they're dropping poop down onto decks, onto people's cars. Whatever is underneath that tree is going to be covered with this stuff, right? Sometimes to the point that irritated customers think it's a bug themselves, right? And now you're getting callbacks not just about real bugs, but about bug poop, right? I've seen it happen in real life. That's why I bring it up. There's all kinds of true bugs out there. Like I mentioned, bugs that are in the same family or same order as bed bugs, but use their piercing, sucking mouthparts to feed on leaf tissue of plants, to feed on seeds of plants, all sorts of things out there, right? Doing that, you know, common ones, you know, need to know which is which. ID is important sometimes. Certain things out there really do look alike. Right, one of these is more of a structural seasonal invader, and one of them isn't. Right, the one on the right is a box elder bug. Right, feeds on the seeds of the box elder, maple, ash tree. It'll come off of those plants as we hit the seasonal, like the program cell death that is fall, right, of plants or trees. When the material that they're feeding on comes off, they move and they look for someplace else to aggregate, mate. Potentially overwinter, right? In the stage that they do that, they'll aggregate on homes. If you disturb them, they put out that so to say, feces or staining of that will stain the home, stain the siding, stain the area where they are. Not necessarily a structural pest. They're not always trying to come in, but something that will damage the exterior. You know, you can do everything you can for your customer, right? This of course is the movie Bad Neighbors. If you haven't seen it, it's juvenile humor, but it's kind of funny. I always forget which one of these guys my wife says I look like, but it's not Zac Efron. But the moral of the story, Bad Neighbors, right? If you can do everything you want for your customer with those box elder bugs or another type of bug of that nature, if the neighbors have ash trees, maple trees, box elder trees, right? The population is over there. So educating, setting up a, a discussion, so to say, with your customer to take to someone else. If they don't have a service or you can't recommend someone, an arborist or someone with that type of license or certification to make on-plant applications, if that's you, I mean, setting yourself up, having the resources, right? Knowing ahead of time and forecasting for what could, you know, you don't want it to be a continuous problem and a callback repeat factory for you when it's at the neighbor's house now, right? That other bug was a milkweed bug. I'm not going to go too deeply into that. Not something that generally aggregates on homes or on structures, but pest control companies are seeing more of them. You know, people are planting more milkweed, right? They're planting more milkweed to help keep monarch butterflies alive. So people are planting things that look a lot like that are going to have pests on them that look a lot like box elder bugs, but not really a big time structural pest that we're dealing with. You know, there's other piercing sucking bugs that kind of look alike that can kind of be confused with each other. I mean, both of these can be, will enter structures seasonally in the fall, right? The one on the right, of course, is that Western conifer seed bug or the pine seed bug, feeds on seeds or cones of conifers. One weird thing about Western conifer seed bugs is they are one of the only other insects that have traumatic insemination. All of us that have sat through a bed bug symposium or two in our lives have heard about traumatic insemination in bed bugs. Western conifer seed bugs do it a little bit differently. But yes, they do have that. They also, you know, they'll seek an overwintering site when pine cones drop, their food source drops, right, to the ground. It's no longer viable. They'll seek to overwinter. They'll move in structures, not really aggregating, more of an accidental, not an adaptive pest. Versus your brown marmorated stink bug, another one that's introduced, right, from China, hundreds of host plants this thing can feed on. Hundreds of host plants, right? It is a stink bug. It puts out that defensive secretion, that smell, right? When it's disturbed, you can have a lot of them on a structure, right? This was updated from the brown marmorated stink bug. Where are you? Website essentially. Stop brownmarmoratedstinkbug.org. But you can see the degree of where we were from Pennsylvania as an introduction, now a severe agricultural and nuisance pest problem, right, in those red states. Orange states, agricultural and nuisance pest problems, right? Yellow, nuisance pest. Green, detected, intercepted. I bet some of those greens eventually turn into nuisance pest problem states also. Right, it has a humongous range, a humongous host plant range, right, and can and will come off of those host plants and begin aggregating, potentially move into structures, right. So if that says no aggregation, they certainly do, as you can see in that picture from Mike Merchant at Texas A&M University. They certainly do aggregate on structures and will seek overwintering sites. Coming from Nebraska, I dealt with one specific piercing sucking insect a lot when it came to the fall. That was minute pirate pugs. That picture doesn't make it look minute, but it really is. Comes off of plants in the fall. Man, does it bite. And you will react and you will welt up, right? The best bet for protecting yourselves from certain piercing sucking insects like this one or lace bugs really is to wear long sleeves, wear clothing. Right, that's going to be your best bet to protecting yourself from biting insects. So a health risk, right? Not necessarily a structural pest, but it becomes a structural pest when it's biting your customers and they don't know what it is, right? And then they're calling you back for something that's not even really something you can treat. That's coming off of a tree or a plant, unless you have that type of licensing. Seasonal pests still, cluster flies. Certain areas have these, you know, these flies. They're actually parasites of earthworms, in an earlier stage of their life, but they enter, they egress, they get up into attic spaces. They gather, they aggregate together to overwinter, a very common fall seasonal pest. Springtails. Bark lice, book lice, you know, outdoor versions of sosids, other very common fall seasonal pests as environments are changing, right? They may move into an area, right? It's getting drier in an area that a springtail had been wet with summer rains all year. It gets drier. Those springtails will try to move to somewhere else, right? And if that's your egress window of the walkout basement of your home, they will try to come through there as a fall seasonal pest, right? I mentioned those entry points. Right. When you're looking at your structures, at your customer structures, be thinking about how and where pests will get into places. Right. That's what we're looking for when we're looking at an inspection, even for general pests. Right. We're looking at entry points. We're thinking about mitigation strategies. Right. Whether that be, you know, like I said earlier in the agenda topic, the corrective action plan. Right. What is our corrective action or what is our mitigation action for these seasonal pests? Right. How or where can we keep them out of places? That's the goal of a program. Right. Focusing on, chemicals are a part of something, but they are not the only part. Right. Pruning back vegetation, looking at plants where some of these, specifically these fall pests may be, right? What can the customer do or who can they contact before this becomes your problem, right? To mitigate it at a source. What sort of weed control, mowing, trimming, edging, water management tools can they do? What sort of structural repairs and upkeep can they do on that structure, right? Maybe this is a service you're offering in some sort of exclusion techniques, right? Like certainly for rodents, I know a lot of pest control companies have upped our wildlife management, right? They've upped their so to say their programs for this and how we're excluding those pests, you know. Wildlife, earlier we had the picture of the seed falling down, that magnolia seed falling down with those red seeds on it still. You know, if you have that sort of tree or something like that around your house, squirrels are going to be coming and attracted to those seeds, right? All sorts of wildlife opportunity, right? Coming, the area around your house now becomes a beacon, right? Of something that is welcoming to those wildlife. And if there's a way in to your chimney or some other access to your house, they will find it, right? But even smaller insect and seasonal pests, caulking, sealing, expandable foams, right? Repair and upkeep of the structure, right? Mechanical control, you know, raking, turning mulch. What landscape procedures can they make that would make them have less smoky brown or American cockroaches or your paradomestic roaches that might come in, right? Web removal isn't just a pest control tool, right? You can always help advise a customer that it's okay to remove a web for you, but sometimes I know that's hard. They don't have 30-foot extension poles with Websters. You know, we do. But I'm hoping that web removal is a service that is on everyone's radar out there in terms of managing seasonal pests. But of course, monitoring, trapping, you know, all the mechanical control tools you can put out to not have to rely as much on chemical controls. You know, I have heard about it or seen about most any way a homeowner can hurt or injure themselves with mechanical control tools, from somebody putting the wrong UV light bulbs in when they were trying to attract cluster flies up in an attic, you know, impacting them, to cutting their hands or pinching themselves and having to go to the hospital because they were taking a mouse out of a mouse trap that you had set, right? Or severely cutting their hands trying to install door sweeps that you recommended or even sold them, right? Sometimes it's best to let professionals handle the equipment, and that can be the messaging that I'll leave that note at. But I've mentioned it a few times: education, 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 right? Anytime we can do that, and that's what we're doing with our forecast, right? We're using and incorporating, sorry, I hit the button twice there, but we're using and incorporating these tools like that NPMA tool, like your local extension or your university extension resources that are out there about these relevant seasonal pests and when and why they're coming out in the first place and when and why they're going to come into your customer structures, right? Use those materials, educate your customers. In the end, that will set expectation and that will keep that customer around, right? In terms of chemicals, there are, you know, it's football season. There are a lot of offenses that are being run out there right now, right? Even for fall invaders, I mentioned the multiple different, you know, service frequencies and multiple different service lines. Each one might involve a different, you know, different formulation of product, whether that be granules, baits, liquid dilutables, right? Different equipment to handle all of those things or apply all of those things, right? So the formation equals your formulation of what product you're using, right? It's equipment specific sometime. And really remember, chemicals and the tools and that is an essential part of an IPM program, but it's not going to succeed without those other elements, right? Without your forecast, without your education and all of that. There are going to be some factors out there that affect the products that you're using, right? What you're spraying it on, whether that be a porous or a non-porous surface, the formulation of your product, so to say, if it's a liquid dilutable, are you applying a microencapsulated product, something that's non-encapsulated? Is it susceptible to degradation faster by light and water, right? That depends on that formulation. Are you giving yourself enough volume, right, to apply to the right areas, right? Are you soaking down enough material, or are you watering in your granules, right, to get down to where in that mulch or that thatch or that pine straw or that leaf litter where those paradomestic roaches are that are going to be climbing up and trying to enter the house, right? Are you applying the right things for those right pests at the right times, like I mentioned earlier, in the right areas? Might it be easier to control some of those piercing, sucking pests somewhere else rather than wait for them to get to the house? But bottom line, a better program, all of those tools together equals a lower reservice rate. And I just repeat again, you don't be a zombie when you're treating homes. Use all those different formulations, use all those different tools, and give yourself the time to do the job right. Right? It's not a race. You are not Usain Bolt. That's what I always tell people. And you're certainly not Usain Bolt carrying a backpack sprayer. But make sure you're diluting your products right. You're applying your products right. Reread your labels, right? That's going to be key. Inspect first, treat second. And the last part there that is always one of the most important parts, if the customer were watching, would you do something different? If your answer is yes to that, remember, the customer is always watching. Don't be a doorbell licker, especially. Don't be a doorbell licker. But take your time. Do your job right. It'll save you a reservice in the long run. Tying it all together, pest control forecasts are essential parts of our business, right? A reliable forecast drives preventive pest management, which is IPM, right? Which is the messaging that all of us need to be constantly relaying to our customers, right? Preventive tools first, right? Reactive tools second. When you're doing that right and you're forecasting right and you're ahead of yourself, even on your own programs or potentially selling other programs, right? You're going to impact your customer expectation. They're going to think of you as that expert, right? That accurate and precise pest forecast expert, and you're going to retain those customers, which drives profit. Straight from Al Roker to end it here, right? Weather forecasting 101, right? Prioritize your timing and the message you're telling to your customers. Tell them about the things they're going to see right before they see them, right? Or a couple services before, if you're trying to sell a new customer, right? What time will I see adult bugs? If I'm the service technician talking to my customer, you know, what am I going to see after this? Or what should I, you should be telling them about what preventive actions they can do before your next service, right? Before that next quarter. So we don't see this happening. So you can have this conversation with this person over here about the problems that you've had in the past, right? Focus on the impact of what you're saying to them, right? Lots of what this means to you is. That's a key sell term right there, folks. What this means to you is, right? Everything that I'm going to do coupled with what you're going to do, this is the result we're going to have. And if it has a health threat associated with it, you know, any sort of health threat or risk threat, tie that into your messaging, right? Get creative with what you're doing. I mean, this is one example from a pest control company here in Georgia that I know that gets creative with billboards, gets creative with advertising, gets creative with weather forecasting or pest forecasting, right? You know, I'm not a wildlife customer. Let's say I'm only a termite customer here. I'm getting wildlife information about pests, you know, what's going to happen seasonally with wildlife. I could get information about, you know, you don't want paradomestic roaches, you know, coming into your house. Here's an email blast about that, right? Get creative in how you're delivering your forecasts, and it will help drive your customer growth. Maybe. Trying to advance forward. All right, last things last. Here we go. You know, I want to thank you all for your time today. Hopefully you've picked up one, two, or three things, or at least some messaging, or how you can think about forecasts and use them in your business for seasonal invaders. You know, I Al Roker had this quote, and I'm going to steal it from him because I think I've been lucky myself to work with some of the best people in the business that have taught me both how to think about this industry and how to work in this industry. So with that, you know, I want folks to keep using the products that they're using now, and I want them to be able to use them for at least the rest of my future in this industry. So always read and follow your label directions, and let's be stewards of the tools that we have. Ellen, I'm done. I know I spoke probably well past my allotted time, but I got the gift of gab, so I'm ready for questions.
All right, perfect. Let's get to questions. We got some questions that we received during the registration and a couple we got during the presentation. So to start us off, one of the questions we got was, right now, populations of the Joro spiders seem to be concentrated in northern Georgia and western South Carolina. But do you foresee this spider spreading to other markets in the coming years? PMP Magazine has a short article about this pest coming up in its November issue, and it kind of tied well into your presentation.
Certainly, I think if you're in the immediate future, if you're in the same climatic range, I expect this thing, there's nothing holding it back other than where it's at now, and it's breeding here this year, and it is an explosion. I'll say that. But it's more of a shock thing to customers too. The webs are huge, interconnected, and the spiders are bigger and they're just more prominent than, you know, you're not seeing the old spiders, your crab spiders, things like that. But in terms of your question, to strictly answer that, I would say yes, I anticipate it slowly moving away from here along these same climate zones.
All right. And then the next question we have is, someone said, I have yellow jackets entering a sensitive commercial structure right now. Why are they doing this, and how should I stop them?
Okay. Yellow jackets, those are going to be fertilized females, fertilized what could be eventual queens. They have left a healthy tree nest or underground nest, most likely looking for an overwintering spot, inadvertently going into this commercial structure. Could be through gaps, cracks in the roofing materials or the fascia line on a building. Could be air handling units on the top of buildings, facility and maintenance places that commercial structures don't like it when you try to blame them. But it's always something you should talk about and look at potentially, because if yellow jackets get into the space of this commercial area, you know, there's that risk with those stinging insects. But they're coming in because they're looking for a place to overwinter. The answer sometimes gets expensive, involving, you know, different treatment strategies, maybe dust application up under that roof fascia line right there, maintenance conversations with you know, facilities operators. Those are going to be the best answers. You have to find a way to exclude them. We can't treat them out of thin air.
All right, and we'll do one more question before you wrap up. So another person said they have a customer with millipede issues every year, doing perimeter sprays and not seeing millipedes in surrounding landscape, but still get callbacks. Do you have any thoughts on how that can be improved?
So they're having millipede callbacks, they're doing perimeter service, and they don't see millipedes around the house. Is that what the question was, Ellen?
Yes, they're not seeing it in the landscapes, but they still have issues with it and still get callbacks.
Oh, okay. No, my only answer would be there. Maybe something. I've had situations where gutter lines or on a commercial site like that where the drain's on the roof and there's organic matter up there that's built up and it's not being cleaned out. or like I said, the gutters are full of leaf litter, wet leaf litter, and the millipedes could be migrating out of that if you're coming if it's drier and they're in there, or it gets too wet or too dry, they could be migrating out of there. If there's callbacks associated with it, they are found in a routine place, right? That's where they live, and it's going to be that rotting organic matter. So if there's still millipedes around and you're treating, either our treatment's not getting to where it needs to in that profile, like I said earlier, take your time, let it soak down, give yourself enough volume, right? A lot of times products have application rates that say, you know, use this much, like use 1 ounce in whatever amount of water you need to apply that 1 ounce to this amount of surface area. So you could give yourself 10 gallons of water to really soak it down in somewhere. So I'm saying look for an alternate site for the millipedes to come from, or make sure you're giving yourself enough time and using enough product, or bring a rake and rake stuff back and then apply underneath that layer of the landscaping, pull some of the landscaping back and make an application under that. Make sure we're giving ourselves enough time, getting the right treatment in the right places. If I'm anticipating a large migration with that question. So I feel like we're missing a harborage, or we're not getting something to the right place.
All right. Well, thank you for answering those questions. Great presentation today. So we'll wrap up the live event. Thank you everyone for attending the webinar today. Let's talk about the weather and its impact on pests, which is brought to you by Pest Management Professional Magazine and our sponsor, BASF. If you have any additional questions for Dr. Husen, you can reach him directly via the contact information you see on the next slide. And a recording of this webinar will be emailed to you tomorrow and posted on mypmp.net/webinars. Upcoming webinars from PMP will also be posted to that page. Thank you all for attending, and we hope you join us again soon for another great webinar.
Thanks, everyone. Everybody be safe out there.